And our next speaker, next we welcome a woman who has worked tirelessly to protect animals and the environment. She's been an active member of Occupy Dallas and has recently been involved with the efforts to stop the Keystone XL pipeline. She's going to talk to us about the tar sands blockade and eminent domain, and this is Tammy Carson. And I just want to say, in addition to that, that she's a very selfless, very dedicated person who does a lot without trying to get herself any of the credit that she might be due for it, which is a thing I certainly respect.
Hear, hear. Hear, hear. Bravo. Bravo.
While Tammy's coming up, I just wanted to give you a message from the prisoners, and they wanted to let you know that if anybody wants seconds, they're there at your service, and so go ahead on through, and here's Tammy.
I'm so happy to be here tonight with friends and fellow activists, and I'll be speaking about eminent domain. Eminent domain is, quote, the power to take private property for public use by a state, municipality, or private person or corporation authorized to exercise functions of public character following the payment of just compensation to the owner of that property, unquote. And TransCanada has done just that. They've basically stolen land from landowners all over East Texas to build the Keystone Pipeline. The Keystone Pipeline will cover 1,700 miles stretching from Alberta, Canada to Port Arthur, Texas. By claiming common carrier status, they have successfully taken land that they should not have been able to take. Common carrier, quote, offers its services to the general public under license or authority provided by a regulatory body, unquote. In Texas, a common carrier has a power to condemn land with little oversight. To earn the designation of common carrier, an oil company only has to claim the status on a one-page form submitted to the Texas Railroad Commission, which regulates pipelines. So I'm going to give you a few examples of people who have had their land taken. In Paris, Texas, Julia Trigg Crawford, who owns 650 acres, fought TransCanada in court. She never signed a contract with TransCanada or took any money from them, but because they claimed common carrier status, they won. Ms. Crawford's counsel argued that TransCanada could not be a common carrier because it carried diluted bitumen, not crude oil, because the Keystone Pipeline had not been granted a federal permit, and because the pipeline company had not negotiated in good faith. Basically, they're lying to people about what's coming through the pipeline. In a 15-word ruling sent from his iPhone, Judge Bill Harris of Lamar County Court upheld TransCanada's condemnation of a 50-foot strip across Ms. Crawford's land. She was served with a writ of possession by TransCanada the morning before the judge's ruling came down. Another example, Michael Bishop owns 20 acres in Douglas, Texas, 160 miles north of Houston, where he lives with his wife and daughter. Initially, he fought the company's attempt to condemn his land, but he couldn't afford the $10,000 lawyer's fee. He settled under duress, but later he decided to defend himself, so he has filed a lawsuit in Austin against the Texas Railroad Commission, which oversees the pipeline, arguing that it failed to properly investigate the pipeline and protect groundwater, public health, and safety. Another example, which is a little more well-known, is Eleanor Fairchild of Winsboro, Texas. She bought her property when her husband retired as an oil industry geologist. The pipeline will permanently bisect the 300-acre ranch, which includes undeveloped wetland areas, natural springs producing over 400 gallons of fresh water per minute from her property. So Ms. Fairchild has not been in favor of the pipeline since she became aware of TransCanada's plans years ago. She never signed a contract, and TransCanada expropriated her ranch through Texas eminent domain legal proceedings. She turned down the one-time settlement offer, and I was with her the day that TransCanada began clearing her land. The Feller Bunchers, it was early on a Sunday morning, and we were sitting on her patio having coffee, and we heard this awful, awful sound, and we knew what it was. They had already begun, the Feller Bunchers had already begun clearing the trees. It was sickening. She and actress Daryl Hannah were arrested on Eleanor's property for trying to stop TransCanada. Maybe you've seen pictures. They stood in front of the heavy machinery with their hands up in the air telling them to stop. And it didn't work. Eleanor was charged with criminal trespass, being on her own property. And she, along with 28 others of us, have been charged with a slap suit by TransCanada. Slap suit means a strategic lawsuit against public participation. And what this means is it's a lawsuit that's intended to censor, intimidate, and silence critics by burdening them with the cost of a legal defense until they abandon their opposition. TransCanada has also threatened landowners who have changed their mind about turning over property to TransCanada for construction. The corporation faces multiple lawsuits for doing this to landowners. And the stories go on and on. Landowners, ranchers, farmers who are lied to and coerced into signing away their land, sometimes land that's been in their family for years, with a threat of having all of their land confiscated. And the bitumen that will be pushed through these inadequate pipes is not crude oil. It's the consistency of peanut butter being diluted with poisonous chemicals. One of them is benzene and other chemicals that have not been disclosed. An example, in July 2010, a pipeline carrying tar sands ruptured and spilled nearly 1 million gallons of diluted bitumen into the Kalamazoo River. 2 years later, the cleanup is still not finished, and a 40-mile stretch of the river remains closed to the public. This pipeline has the potential to be the worst environmental disaster to date. A number of environmental groups are speaking out against the pipeline. The Sierra Club, 350.org, Idle No More, Rising Tide, and a group that I'm associated with, the Tar Sands Blockade. Yay! We do non-violent direct action and acts of civil disobedience. We hold rallies and marches, street theater and skits to help alert the public about what's going on. We assist landowners with support. There was a tree sit for 80 days to block the pipeline. We chain ourselves to equipment to shut down their facilities. And this past Monday, we disrupted business as usual at the offices of TransCanada in Houston. And most recently, in an act of solidarity, eight students in Massachusetts chained themselves together and super glued their hands together in TransCanada's offices to protest this. So I want to urge you all to investigate this most dangerous and disastrous pipeline, and then join us. Let your voice be heard. Stand up and say, this is not okay. This is our Earth. We have one planet. We have the power to make this a better place. And we owe it to our children and grandchildren to do that. Sit down. You've got to get on with the evening. Our next speaker is Charles Hillman. Charles Hillman started his community development activities as a member of the Dallas chapter of the Black Panther Party. He has served on the Cultural Affairs Commission, City of Dallas, DART Art Advisory Board, and has been a member of the Dallas Business Committee on the Arts. A co-founder of the South Dallas Cultural Center and the Harambee Festival, he is now a community arts development consultant and president of the Martin Luther King Library Friends Support Group. He'll speak to us today about issues facing the African American community and environmental racism. Please welcome Charles Hillman.
Representing the Martin Luther King Jr. Library Friends Support Group. We are a community-based organization. Our primary mission is to promote justice and peace through literacy, knowledge, and education. Thank you for inviting us to share our view on the issues affecting civil rights in the Black community. we are in big trouble. The DISD school board voted to close 3 elementary schools in our neighborhood. The homeless population has doubled. Affordable housing stock is shrinking. There are blocks and blocks of vacant lots. The unemployment rate is 4 times higher in the black community. Crack cocaine and other drugs have all but taken over. Police use of deadly force is on the rise. And DART just got a raise. So now poor people will have to pay $5 for transportation. Now this is the background, this is the status of civil rights in the African American community. And what are poor people going to do? Now let me talk about an issue that is off the radar, that you don't hear the politicians talk about. You don't hear the preachers talk about. It's environmental racism. Alert! 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 Warning! 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 Do not drink the water. Do not drink the tap water. There's been a little problem with the city of Dallas's water treatment plant. Do not drink the water. Will cause serious health problems. We can't even drink the water. Now how in the world are poor people expected to buy bottled water? Now, I've got nothing against bottled water, but in the list of priorities in my community, bottled water is not one of them. I can just see it now. Hey, brother, don't drink from that water fountain. You got to go to Menards and buy a bottle of water. Man, I thought this was America, not some third world country. Environmental racism is alive and well in Southern Dallas. From increased trash in the city's landfill to a factory dumping pig blood in the Trinity River. There are many environmental hotspots in Southern Dallas. On the corner of MLK Boulevard and Malcolm X, that's a hotspot. Directly across the street is a nursing home. Do you think they got some bottled water there? Dry cleaners in the area dump used chemicals directly in the street. School children walk in these chemicals every day. And let's not forget our good neighbors, the wrecking yards and the metal recycling plants. So what about the water? Now for the good news. We must continue to build progressive coalitions with other organizations. We must hold our leaders and politicians accountable. We must join the human rights movement. You know, if Dr. King was alive today, he wouldn't be talking about civil rights. He'd be talking about human rights.
Amen.
So join us to stop the war. Join us in saving the water. And join us fighting the power. Thank you. Speaker is a Wright's graduate and former naval officer who served as a submarine commander in the Antarctic, representing Veterans for Peace. He's here to speak to us about indefinite detention and the National Defense Authorization Act. Please give a warm welcome to Grant Youngsman.
Inspiring
speeches tonight that I would simply read all of the NDAA. has anyone here read the entire NDAA? Anybody not know what it is? Has anyone actually read Section 1021 in its entirety? A few. Has anyone read the authorization for the use of military force? A couple. I could read that whole thing tonight. It's only a page and a half. And it is the document that was an act that was enacted after September 11th that the people who support Section 1021 of the NDAA refer back to that grants the president the power to indefinitely detain or basically do anything he wants to anyone in the interest of fighting the war on terror. The authorization for the use of military force actually makes no reference to indefinite detention or detention of any kind, because it's moot on that subject and gives the president tremendous powers to do whatever is necessary to fight the war on terror. Many people consider Section 1021 of the NDAA, and Section 1021 addresses detention and addresses terror, acts of terror, the war on terror, that it gives the authority to 1021 for this indefinite detention. The NDAA in 2011, the first time, affirmed the right to hold suspected terrorists or supporters of terrorists indefinitely and without charge. And at issue, or the primary issue, is whether or not U.S. citizens can actually be detained. This year's Senate bill says that citizens can't be detained in the U.S., but it's unclear whether they can be detained somewhere else. I mean, can you detain them in Puerto Rico if you can't detain them in the U.S., or in Cuba, or someplace that's not part of the U.S. law? So on January 3rd this year, Obama signed the 2013 version of the NDAA. Attempts were made to clarify this whole issue of indefinite detention, specifically related to U.S. citizens. Senator Feinstein and I think the other gentleman that sponsored the bill was Hill. There was an amendment that was passed 90 whatever it is to zero by the Senate to limit the ability to detain U.S. citizens under Section 1021 of the NDAA. The problem is that the Constitution applies to persons in the U.S. and not just U.S. citizens. That means it applies to everyone here. It doesn't matter whether you're a citizen or a legal resident or you just came across the border from Mexico. The Constitution applies to you if you live here. And so there was some concern that the Feinstein Amendment would actually create issues with people who are not citizens relative to indefinite detention. Ultimately, the amendment was dropped, and the President signed the 2013 NDAA, as is, still being extremely vague on whether or not U.S. citizens can be detained at all, and can be detained indefinitely. There was an additional section kept, I probably have the number somewhere, lost it, Section 1029 added a provision that related to habeas corpus for persons within the U.S. so that you could at least be brought up before a judge, but it didn't address the provisions for detention. It doesn't address the lack of formal charge. It doesn't address jury trials. It doesn't address any other protection offered anyone in the U.S. under the Constitution. So the The NDAA is vague on the entire issue of detention of U.S. citizens. The courts have ruled against, have stayed the ruling, have done basically nothing at this point that clarifies the issue. And so you have a lot of lips moving on the subject, but nothing concrete has happened with the whole notion of indefinite detention, specifically of U.S. citizens. And we have, I mean, that's not the only problem. We have detainees in Gitmo, we have detainees in foreign prisoners, in foreign prisons in Europe and that part of the world. And none of this has been addressed, other than the fact that the president can basically do what he pleases at this point. He can also order the Gitmo detainees home. He can bring an end to indefinite detention, and he can simply not enforce provisions of the bill which might cause the detention of U.S. citizens. Which he said in his signing letter to the 2012 bill that he would not enforce, or he would do so judiciously or only under very rare circumstances or something. I don't have the exact wording. But in his signing letter to the 2013 version of the NDAA, he didn't address indefinite detention at all. So the real issue is that it's vague. We don't know whether we can be detained or not. Odds are we can at this point. It's a bad thing. And it's just two little parts of a 500 and almost 600 page act. They're just two sections that are the real problem. The rest of it is budgets and